This meeting is now being recorded.
Okay, let's go ahead and get started, everyone. As always, we have myself, Adam Knudsen, Director of Sales here at TBI, and with me I have Dave Landsberger, who heads up our training department.
Hey guys, how are you today?
So today we're going to talk about IT stress and the revenue potential that our partners have with this particular solution. We're going to have three webinars on this, but today is really to talk about how to engage in that conversation, the types of problems and stress you're going to be able to solve, and then the revenue potential, but why do you want to get involved in this in addition to what you're already selling with TBI. So looking at a lot of the conversations we've already talked about, we talked about in our cloud webinar series, how to have a different conversation with director of IT or CIO or anyone who is in your contact with an organization to change the conversation you're having, not about price, not just about, you know, when their contract's up, but really about what are their business problems. So sitting down with your customers is no different with these, with managed IT solutions or outsourced IT, whichever you want to call it. It's about sitting down and saying, what business problems do you have, and listening. So when we talked about the last webinar was analyzing your customers, and it's about understanding not just what's going on in the IT department, but what's going on in the company as a whole. So as you sit down with them, you're looking at what are the next 24 months are objectives that I should help with. And they may not specifically be IT. So you're saying that our owner or our C-suite are saying these are the objectives for the next 2 years. This is where we want to be. This is where we're going to be successful. And then you move into the conversation about how is IT going to enable that to happen. We've talked about a lot about IT being its own, you know, little section inside the company that's helping all these other departments enable, you know, what their initiatives are through technology. They're like an outsourced IT within their own company, right? So how can you help with that is by understanding what their business objectives are and then how those initiatives are affecting that IT department.
And just to kind of piggyback off of what Adam was just saying there, what we're really looking at when we talk about IT is where people meet the technology.
I really like that.
Right? So how is our staff interacting with the technology? I'm not just the user experience level. We're talking about an optimization level. And what types of time is our internal staff spending on particular tasks that might be menial as opposed to something that's a little bit more strategic? And that's really one of the overarching things to consider when we do start talking about managed IT and some of the benefits.
Yeah, so as you understand what their business at large is focused on for that year, you can look to see what projects can you do to help meet the demands of those people through technology. So looking at IT outsourcing, this is going to range for a lot of products, and we'll go over some of those products in the next webinar where we're looking to get into the weeds about what are all the solutions within our managed IT portfolio that you can offer to your customers. But we wanted to begin that today with understanding why you want to do that, what and how to change that type of conversation. But we work with these four for a variety of solutions, ranging from help desk, you know, helping manage endpoints, all the way into, you know, cloud enablement and consulting services. So there's a very wide range of IT solutions that we can help with. So just keep these in mind as you go forward. Engage your CM, engage me and Dave as you're going forward with wanting to understand more about these particular providers. So what are these solutions going to solve? What IT stress or IT problems are these going to solve? So as you have these conversations, talk to them about the business problems, understanding then what kind of projects you might want to be able to help with, listening very clearly to what they have, maybe even leaving, coming back, talking to TBI and a few providers, and then presenting a few solutions to those customers would be a great way to go about it. So what are some of those replies look like is what we want to cover here.
My organization cannot keep up with the demand of technology. The IT department is overwhelmed. Users are frustrated with tools and cannot successfully perform their task, and my capital investment is not producing a return.
Yeah, so this is looking at, you know, kind of like a financial aspect of it to say, you know, we only the IT department has X budget, or the owner is saying this is the kind of budget we have for technology and IT at large. And how do we meet those demands with that limited amount of staff and budget? One of the ways you can do that is by outsourcing certain tasks. So this is looking at moving from, everyone knows the OPEX versus CAPEX discussion as far as cloud goes, but that certainly pertains to this as well, is to say, how can I offload some of that cost? How can I offload some of the expertise into a model that allows me to achieve what I want to in my department while still meeting the budget needs? So I enable an outsourced IT to be part of my overall IT department, and it's really helping me achieve at the end of the day the needs that my owner or C-suite is requiring of me in my IT department. So the next one is, I wish my IT organization had more impact on the value proposition, growing our revenues, and helping to differentiate our firm from the competition. I believe technology can help, but it seems there is never enough time to focus attention on the future because we are always fixing the daily issues.
So this really points to an IT staff and IT leaders who are basically spending all their time doing help desk tickets.
Yeah.
Right? No one got into IT to do help desk tickets. Right? That wasn't the goal when these people signed up for their schooling, their extensive schooling, to learn how to do these types of programming or engineering. And it's important, this particular example is very important because it showcases a desire to be more strategically aligned with the rest of the company, right? How can I move away from these more custodial types of duties and really start bringing something to the boardroom, really start bringing something to our financial planning and the scaling of our organization as we try to move forward? So this is a good situation to me, because this leader, if you were to get the sort of response from your own customer community, this indicates somebody who wants to do more, who wants to get more strategic, and wants to get a little bit more out of the time and the resources that they currently have.
Yeah, as Dave said, when we were kind of first going over these conversations together, this type of response and this type of mentality is really your ideal customer and your ideal CIO or director of IT that they want to get out of the day-to-day monotony of answering problems with Excel or what the heck's wrong with Adams Exchange, why can't I get emails. They don't want to be spending their time doing that. They want to be a part of the business, solving the business problem at large, and be part of the revenue stream. I mean, everyone knows that at the end of the day, sales and development are what drive a company and what drive results in people's eyes. So being able to be a part of that is a lot more fun to be strategic, to just say it simply.
The speed of technology is overwhelming. My people have great talent, but they cannot keep up, and I cannot afford the resources to ensure they are properly trained. I wish I could help them focus on one or two items, complete those tasks, and then move on. Instead, we try and do everything, and we only achieve average results.
Yeah, so this is a growing problem as companies, again, say it'll be a two-part. With the first response, where we talked about finance. So, of course, everyone has a somewhat of a finite budget in their department, and they have their goals for the next 24 months, and they need to achieve certain things with technology. So maybe they're rolling out an e-commerce site. Maybe they're moving their services, their on-prem servers, into the cloud, or maybe they're deploying a tablet where they're using analytical information from the field to bring back into a server and then analyze what all that information needs. So those three examples all take very specific experts within a company to understand how that technology is going to be enabled to the end user, and then how we're going to maintain that technology and then use it to help the rest of the business. So as we move things into the cloud, we need cloud experts. So that's one of the things that we've seen in a CompTIA analyst report, which we'll go over in a second, but that you don't always have to just look at this as, well, if I'm doing outsourced IT, I'm just replacing everyone on staff. Really, it's not necessarily that. It's where can I get specific geeks, I guess we could call it for this instance, or specific specialists that know how to do these specialized things. You don't have to have jack-of-all-trades on staff. You can have them know how to do one or two things very well. And then you run into a project where they're not really going to be the best person. You don't have to just throw them into that, hope they succeed, or get them training. You can rely on an outsourced IT partner to then offload that specialty on. And maybe they can just, maybe that person would be managing the project and you have specialists from that outsource. So as specializations change or the number of specializations increase within a company, you're going to see a lot more need for this to diversify exactly where they're getting those resources from. The last one is we cannot find enough qualified people for all the competency required. Our turnover is excessive. When we do find someone and they become productive, they seem to be recruited away. The urgency of technology and the sensitivity created when tools are not running properly is very frustrating. I wish I could focus on running my business instead of feeling held hostage to technology.
So IT professionals are in high demand and they know it. Okay, IT recruiting is a very lucrative business. And one of a CIO's most common challenges is going to be, you know, I can find people who can do the tasks, but can I find people who can lead at the same time? Those people are incredibly valuable, right? So in this scenario, we see a customer who's kind of feeling that pain point, as well as just kind of being maybe saddled with a bunch of legacy technologies as well, right? They have a plethora that maybe was left by a previous CIO that they have to deal with and they have to manage, right? They don't want to be held to that anymore. They want to innovate. They want to move forward. They're basically feeling as if they have to answer to all the technologies that the company has instead of moving forward and trying to address, okay, what are the problems with future and how do I cut them off right now?
Yeah, I think that's something to really take note of is the last part of being held hostage to your technology. So Dave's right. I think in this instance, it was pertaining to a legacy system. And we've talked about that as far as, you know, competitive scape in our state of the industry is that there's a lot of startup companies that have immediately been able to compete with, you know, global large companies, compete with them on a global scale on existing incumbent large companies because they've been able to be so flexible in how they go to market. Their marketing go to market strategy, their use of big data analytics with their customers and being able to be much more flexible, much more nimble with how they go to market and they're in a lot of instances crushing these older companies that are being dragged down by these existing systems. So in this scenario, having a partner like an outsourced IT available to you can help with A, the consistency. So you have a consistent partner, so if you do get someone recruited away, you still have the consistency of that managed IT provider to be a part of your organization, an extension of your IT organization as a customer. And then additionally, like we already talked about, it's about those specialties. So as you're moving into away from legacy systems or improving existing legacy systems, you can rely on new specialists without having to go through the process of hiring, you know, a whole bunch of new IT staff that specialize in all those things. So two examples we've kind of already talked about these, but these are examples of not having to completely move IT staff to get away from the thought process that you're always going to be firing people. I think that's one of the issues is, you know, with cloud services or offering managed IT solutions and having these types of conversations, there is a concern for, you know, staff just wanting to be, you're just going to flip them. So the guy that you're talking to is going to get fired because you move into a cloud server and he was a cloud server guy. That's not always the case. And I think more times than not that it's not. I mean, in general, departments have a budget. They know what they need to do. And this is the tool that enables them to continue to innovate, continue to grow as a company. And they want to grow those people within there. Think of your own staff, your own employees. You don't really want to get rid of them. You would rather help them do something else different, maybe something more strategic, more tied to revenue that helps the company grow. So a particular scenario is shifting management of servers to the cloud. So maybe you had an employee that was managing your on-prem servers or your co-location facility, sitting in the cage all day long. Now you don't need them to do that because you've moved to a fully managed cloud solution on that particular either application or database that person was managing. You can then shift their employment. They can go get cloud certified and they can be focused on how to operate in those portals and make sure that, you know, they're working directly with the provider to keep a great experience for the end user. So that's one scenario where they could be moved from managing a data center, more or less, your own rack space, to moving into a space where they're helping manage all the cloud solutions and providers that you're working with.
Another example here is just relieving the help desk hours, right? So the employees can focus on new specialties or technology development projects. We have a couple help desk technicians here. They're fantastic at their jobs. I have no doubt in my mind they'd rather work on other projects.
Yeah.
Right? I mean, and this is a really easy fix, but it's so time consuming, guys. If you don't have somebody in your own staff who sorts your IT help desk troubleshooting, maybe you do it yourself, it's really time consuming, and you probably know that already. All right? We're paying these people. We're paying these people, and we hired them because we thought they were smart, because they had a lot of aptitude, because hopefully they had some leadership qualities as well. Why don't we let them flex those muscles instead of just responding to trouble tickets all day long? Let's stop fighting fires, and let's start moving forward with our IT department so it can be a business enabler.
Yeah, so that's the best part is that, again, it's the best of both worlds where the company sees that vision, your employees are getting to grow, and you're able to offload this while, you know, still maintaining some semblance of a budget that was passed down to you for the year or the next 2 years. So looking at what does that mean for, you know, a particular employee's job security. So these are some points. 53% of companies that, in this survey, 53% of companies that used managed service today said that they kept their internal IT headcounts exactly the same. 15% of companies simply had no internal IT staff to begin with, so that's just a windfall, right? If you're talking to SMBs or, you know, companies that are growing very quickly is a great one where they've been SMB but all of a sudden they're, you know, bringing in millions of dollars of revenue. Those companies are struggling and very quickly need to outsource CIO services, need to outsource help desks, whatever they need help with. That's just a windfall conversation. If you talk to someone that says, an owner or a C-level that says, we've grown so much in the last year and we're expecting this much growth, we need serious help, those are great companies to talk to. 25% of companies made some reductions to headcount. So here we are at least recognizing that it's a possibility and that it can happen. It's a reality of the situation. But we just wanted to point out the adage that there shouldn't be this complete fear that it's just going to crush everyone's job. It was 25% of the people in the survey. And then lastly, 6% of the companies actually eliminated their in-house staffing. So I don't know the average number of employees they let go, but it's definitely something to think about. Is that as you're going through this process, that these are real, these can be real concerns of customers. But again, it's very good to position yourself as a solution to their business problems and a solution to what they need to accomplish in the next 2 years, rather than, you know, the fear of having to just replace other people. It's about having a plan for their department.
If I'm a true leader in a company, you know, and I work in IT, which I don't, so maybe I'm making an assumption and I shouldn't, I would view this as an opportunity, right? If I can bring in someone to handle the more menial tasks of my day-to-day, all right, that opens up an entirely new proving ground to me as a leader to find more value for the company, right? And if we're trusting our hiring practices within the company as a whole, all right, we should be able to move people around into different tasks, and they should be successful.
Absolutely. So this is a snippet from the CompTIA buying guide, and I would encourage all of you to reach out to the webinars@tbi.com distro, reach out to your channel manager, me and Dave directly, whichever one you want to get a hold of. But I would get this CompTIA buying guide from us. It's a really great guide to look at, you know, what kind of information is being disseminated down to customers, what they're responding to as far as surveys go, on what they're looking for in a managed service provider. And a really great section of this as well was what questions should they ask of a managed service provider as they're going down that road. So some of the top 10 factors driving this adoption, though, is what we wanted to cover here, just a few of them. So number one was improved security. We talked about this in our State of the Industry, that security is going to be a big play this year. We'll be going over some security webinars, a few webinars from now. But that's going to be a very important topic for this year. As you all know, it's been heavily publicized. As we move more into Internet of Things, as time goes on with logistics, We're going to see a lot more scrutiny with this. As things move into the cloud, again, you know, we're going to see more scrutiny with needing to have the necessary security on their network within their cloud provider. Those are all going to be very big concerns for companies. So it's nice to see that improved security is something they're willing to talk to more or less a trusted advisor and a managed service provider. Next was a proactive approach to IT problems. That goes back to, you know, getting enabled to have people help you with, you know, managing your edge devices. So having a proactive way to approach your technology problems. So latency is a really easy one to think about. Instead of your customer emailing you and saying, hey, we're having latency problems or they can't access this or we're down completely now, you can have a proactive managed IT provider that's monitoring that or helping the customer realize that these things are happening. And they can actually put in proactive tickets to the provider to say, hey, we're experiencing latency before it even goes down and becomes a serious problem for one circuit. So for circuits or devices or Wi-Fi routers, all these things can be managed remotely from a single location to say and to give proactive notification rather than them contacting you and saying, hey, I'm down, I need help with this.
To me, number three, you know, directly ties into that, number two, right? Better uptime. So I'll skip over to number four, you know, gaining access to newer technologies. To me, that ties in to number eight, tapping into cloud solutions, you know, as one of those newer technologies. This can be an easy entry point for someone to go into the cloud because the managed service provider can give that customer the leadership that they so desperately needed to make that jump, okay? So they're not only going to get the newer technologies that they don't want to buy and now prefer to rent, but they're also going to make that final jump, finally move into a cloud environment, and do so with the guidance of a subject matter expert.
Yeah, I mean, we've talked about this previously where if you have a customer that's said, you know, they know they want to move in the cloud, but they don't have the specialist on staff to say, you know, this database or this application should go to the cloud, this one should stay on-prem. We have a provider in GMark that will help you with that. They will help you with the consultative cloud process of, to say, you know, sit down with the customer and say, here's what we think, here's what you're going to have to do to change your network architecture to make this work, here's what we think should be private, here's what could be flexible with public. So just remember that if you have customers that are willing to discuss these business problems with you and are ready to move to that, that you have a trusted consultant that can help you help the customer move to that space. So this is, I guess, a final example about needing specialists. Gartner's, one of their big market trends was specific to driving a managed analytics service provider so that they're helping with the example when I pointed out if you have big data, say you have a whole bunch of information about customers or you have a whole bunch of information about your employees and what they're doing with internally within your staff, logistics with machinery, you know, or logistics with packaging, whatever your data may be, and then what do I do to get that business intelligence? And how do I enable, you know, my software to actually make that data worthwhile to my sales team, to my marketing team, to the executives, what information do they all want? So it is about having specialists on IT staff. So if you decided, if you learned on with that company, well, we have a huge focus on analytics. Well, Gartner's talking about that there's a lot of pressure for these companies to drive performance. And that kind of goes to the fact that these managed service providers, they have to solve a problem. You're not just buying a service. You're really, truly buying a solution to a problem. And so because there's all this competition in this particular, scenario, that these managed analytic providers are being driven to provide the service to customers because they don't have someone on staff to do that. So the results have to be real. They're not just buying a program, go figure out how to use it. It's really, at the end of the day, is that customer satisfied with how you help them deploy this? And it becomes truly an extension of their IT organization to say, how well do we deploy this and how well can they use this information to make better decisions within that company? So BI and analytics, great thing to think about. So moving into what managed IT can look like to you for a revenue standpoint. And there's two things that I think I would like you all to consider And if you don't know this information already, go back and take a hard look at the numbers and how you're running your own business. So looking at analyzing your revenue per opportunity. So take a look and see what is my average revenue per opportunity that I've sold over my life. So the next one that's very important is analyzing your time spent per opportunity. So how much time do you spend on a single opportunity, and then look at how much revenue you make per opportunity. And I think the more times than not, you'll find that you're spending a heck of a lot of time in post-sales. And one of the things we're seeing, at least in TBI right now, is that a managed service opportunity is 10 times as much as the average opportunity placed through TBI. So that's a small snippet, but just understand that these opportunities are much larger scale, even for an SMB customer that was just looking for some simple connectivity, that you can offer some real solutions that give you much more revenue per the time you spend on it.
So in this example, right, we have $5,000 a month in savings just for help desk for a company size of 50 to 100 employees. So we keep on coming back to this help desk tickets, right? This saves $5,000 a month, and a lot of that is in time. A lot of that is just an optimization, right, about freeing up these employees and also getting your trouble tickets sorted much faster, okay? But in this particular example, $5,000 a month for this type of a company size, this is a powerful figure, all right? And this is something that you can present to a company of that size to demonstrate some of the savings that they could experience.
So looking at data and voice implementation, I mean, you all are very familiar with that. And we did surveys and we talked to one of our top partners. And we found that implementation takes 80% of a partner's time and what they do. And it's not just that initial implementation. It's also having to deal with something you sold maybe 2 years ago. You're adding circuits, or they're having latency issues, or they're having downtime. Managed IT, along with those continued network sales, is you're not just throwing away that business to the wayside. But what you are doing is you're using managed IT to have a deeper conversation with that customer, and you're actually selling a solution to a problem. You can become proactive with their latency issues. You can become a deeper business partner with that customer by offering help desk solutions. And really at the end of the day, as you're looking at your average spend per opportunity, your average revenue per opportunity, you're going to spend a lot less time on each sale, which is plainly, it's increasing your profit per opportunity. And that's what we want to look at presenting to you for managed IT solutions. Is at the end of the day, it's increasing the amount of revenue and lessening the amount of time you have to spend on every opportunity.
So, yeah, just to reinforce, this is not a product, right? This is a solution. Therefore, your approach is going to have to change from the get-go. Having a more consultative approach is what someone is going to expect from a solution type sale, as opposed to here's my product, it's in a box, scan it, give me my money, and I'm out of here. All right. You're going to be managing this relationship moving forward, and that should not be seen as a point of stress. That should mean that that constant engagement presents more opportunities to you, and the opportunities come easier because you're just more engaged for a longer period of time.
Yeah, one of the things you'll see in that CompTIA buying guide is take a look at that, or a lot of the information out there in the industry about, you know, how to go about choosing a cloud provider as well, is that convergence, we've talked about convergence and what it means to us in the channel. It is about these types of solutions, getting a little bit deeper with the customer. But to a customer, convergence have a lot to do with trust. It has a lot to do with having a trusted partner that is really an extension of their business that they can trust to help them make the right decisions, that they can trust to outsource, you know, certain aspects of their company away to. And so I think that you'll see as you build that trust with our providers and then your customers with you and those providers that you'll become an awesome solution to their company on a business level and not just a product level. So, like we were saying before, if you're interested in learning more, please contact your channel manager. One thing I wanted to make sure that is if you would like help on how to have these conversations, we would love to sit down with you and talk that through. How do I start presenting that to existing customers? We would love to sit down with you, Dave, myself, or your CM. If you are already having these conversations with your customer and they come to you and say, here's what our objectives are, please come back to us and say, here's what my customer said, and we would love to sit down and help you come up with a few specific solutions that might be great for that customer to look at and for you to present to them. So we'll enable you to do that. So that's interesting to learn more. Also, the CompTIA buying guide, please reach out if you'd like a copy of that. It's a really great thing to learn about what your customers are looking for in an MSP.
Okay, guys, next webinar, 2 weeks from today, February 18th at 1:30 p.m. Central, will be our second webinar on managed IT solutions. So we're going to take this a step further, look at a couple more specific scenarios, all right, dive down a little bit deeper, and present you guys with some real-life application and some real products that you can start talking about, or solutions, I should say, not products.
Yeah, I mean, I know we're trying to just hammer down that these are solutions, not products, and that these customers are all going to have different issues, but we want to at least enable you with a few things to think about as you're talking to your customers. Again, it's a consultative service. It's about their business problems, but we certainly want you to understand, you know, what goes into help desk, what goes into circuit or edge device management, or what goes into, you know, evaluating cloud services or BI analytics. So we'll go into that pretty deep next time. It'll be heavy product focused on understanding what the array of managed IT solutions out there is. So thanks for everyone's time. We always appreciate it. Please send feedback to webinars@tbicom.com, any specific questions you may have with this topic, and we look forward to seeing you in 2 weeks.
Thanks for your time, guys. Have a good one.